Hello and welcome to the Snapcast, dealing with mole-type calculations in AS Module 1. It's the first of three parts. Here we look at June 07 and June 06. A word of warning that one can't escape mole calculations, and you'll find quite often that moles come into not one but two or three different questions in your papers. Very often involved in questions that might be described as application of your chemistry. If you're not good, if you're not sound with moles, then it's going to be a serious weakness, and it's something that you must work with. The best thing to do is to work with moles regularly and build up your confidence. Okay, do pause and have a go at all these questions. So how did you get on with this one? Did you get this? Magnesium's the answer. Let's see why. Always a very good idea to have an inclination to change all other units into moles, like for example the 0.84 grams of this metal carbonate, MCO3. In this formula, MCO3, we know that the C contributes to the overall atomic relative molecular mass. It contributes 12. We know that three oxygens contribute 3 16s, 48. Together they contribute 12 and 48, 60. The rest will be contributed by this unknown metal, M. Over here, we've got concentration in cubic centimeters. We'll want to change that into moles of hydrochloric acid. Two useful rearrangement triangles. How do we express moles? Mole is the mass of the chemical divided by its relative molecular mass. You know how these rearrangement triangles work. You cover what you want and you read off what is left. For example, if I wanted the relative molecular mass from the other two, I would cover that and read off what's left, which in this case is relative molecular mass equals the mass divided by the number of mole. Another rearrangement triangle, this time with mole and concentration. How do we express concentration? It's the number of moles that we have in a cubic decimeter. Remember the volumetric flask? Think of a solution of sodium chloride that is one molar, one capital M, or in modern day units, one mole per cubic decimeter, written like that. That and that are the same. A one molar solution is one mole in a cubic decimeter. Cubic decimeter being 1,000 cubic centimeters, or in old fashioned terms, 1 litre. We always should have in our mind a sense of a standard unit for different things, like distance. What do you think of? A mile? You should have some concept of what a mile is. Distance from your school to the railway station, for example. Or maybe you work with kilometers, and again you should have some sense of what a kilometer is. Distance from your school to the center of the town, perhaps. When it comes to moles, again you should have some rough concept of what a mole is. What does it look like? A mole of water is 18 grams or 18 cubic centimeters of water. Small a cupful, in other words. When it comes to the standard unit for concentration, you should visualize this, a volumetric flask, a liter flask, or better still, a cubic decimeter flask, and think of having taken a mole of a chemical. For example, sodium chloride, a mole is 58.5 grams. Dissolve it in water, pour the water into this volumetric flask here, and then fill it up with water up into the neck of the flask to the mark. What have you got? You have exactly a mole, 58.5 grams, dissolved in water and made up to 1 litre, 1 cubic decimeter, 1,000 cubic centimetres. How do we express concentration? The number of moles in a cubic decimetre. Again, this rearrangement triangle can be used in the same way as the last one. If we wanted moles, for example, we cover mole and we read what's left, taken to be a multiplying sign here between the concentration and the dm cubed. Hope this is coming out okay. And we get mole is equal to concentration t- times the volume in cubic decimeters. Alright, using these figures up at the top right, let's work out the number of moles of hydrochloric acid used in this reaction. And it's the concentration, which is 1.0, times the volume in cubic decimeters. How do we change 20 cubic centimeters to cubic decimeters? We divide by 1,000. 20 divided by 1,000 is 0.02 dm cubed. So down here, 0.02. And that gives us the number of mole, which comes out clearly to be 0.02 mole of HCl. Now we turn to this important balanced symbol equation here to work out the reacting numbers of moles. And we see that we need twice as many moles of HCl as of MCO3. So I now know the number of mole of MCO3 involved in this reaction. It's going to be half as many moles, so it's 0.01 mole. Now I also know that that is equal to 0.84 grams. After all, up here at the top left hand corner, we see that we start with 0.84 grams. So I've got, in terms of the MCO3, I've got its number of moles and I've got its mass. And remember how this rearrangement triangle here was used? RMM of the magnesium carbonate is the mass divided by the number of mole. The mass is 0.84. The number of mole is 0.01, and that comes out to a figure of 84. Now if you remember up here at the top center, we had reasoned that in the formula MCO3, the C had contributed 12, the 3 O's 48, giving us a total there of 60, and the remainder must be contributed by the M. So in this case, the relative atomic mass of M must be 84, take away the 60, which gives us 24, and that tells us that it's magnesium. It has a relative atomic mass of 24. Moving on, pause and have a go. How did you get on? Did you select A, 10A? Remember, there are three types of graph in respect to this particular thing. We can have strong acid, strong base. Now, if we put 7 here in each case for the pH, we have pH on the y-axis, and let's consider that we're adding acid on the... So here we have volume of acid. Now, with the strong acid, I'll write SA for that, strong acid, and SB for strong base. This, remember, is the pH 7 in each instance. We get a graph that looks something like this. Here, in the next case, we'll look at strong acid, weak base. Now, because we've got a weak base, we're going to be starting off not way up here high, in, like in this instance, at a pH of about 12, when we're starting fairly low down here. But it'll go, the bottom part of this graph will look like the first one. In the case of a weak acid, strong base, we're going to be starting high up, but we're not going to be coming down just as far because it's a weak acid. We'll be finishing off somewhere here. And then when we have a weak acid and a weak base, we don't get any vertical section at all to the graph this time. We get something sort of vaguely like this, where no indicator is suitable. Now, you should recall that phenolphthalein comes in around here somewhere. Its colour changes around there. That's phenolphthalein, put just P for that. Whereas methyl orange comes in around here somewhere. I'll put M for methyl orange. So what I'm saying is phenolphthalein is coming in around 8.5 to 10 sort of area. Methyl orange coming in around about 3 to 4.5. Now, with this first graph here, number 1, phenolphthalein and methyl orange will do for both of them will do for a strong acid, strong base. When it comes to a strong acid here, which one of those will be unsuitable because it's not, the indicator is not changing within the vertical section of the graph? Phenolphthalein will be unsuitable, whereas methyl orange is suitable. What about the third one here, the weak acid strong base? This time phenolphthalein is suitable, but methyl orange down here is unsuitable. And for number four, no indicator suitable. You need to have a pH meter here. The reason that A is the answer is because here we're dealing with a strong acid and a weak base. And you can see that phenolphthalein, which is coming in here, it's changing its colour in a pH range that does not correspond to that section of the graph where the line is virtually vertical. What about this one here? Why is it satisfactory? Remember, in this case we're looking for the one that would not be suitable. Why is methyl orange suitable here? Well, here we have a strong acid, again, weak base, and you can see that refers to graph 2 here, and methyl orange is changing here. Its colour change corresponds to where the graph is vertical. What about this one here? Here we've got a strong acid, strong base. Well, either methyl orange or phenolphthalein would have suited. That was graph 1. And what about this one here? Ethanoic acid's a weak acid, and sodium hydroxide's a strong base. We're referring to graph 3 here, and you'll notice that phenolphthalein is indeed, there's it there, is indeed a suitable indicator in that it changes its colour corresponding to the vertical part of the graph. Moving on. Pause and have a go. Okay, let's make use of oxidation numbers here to help us balance this reaction. Reacting iodide ions with iodate ions and acid, which are represented by H+, and that's going to produce iodine and water. Now, the oxidation number, that should be I O minus there, of course. We need to work out the oxidation number of the iodine in the iodate ion here. And the overall charge on the ion is -1. The oxidation number of oxygen is -2, except in the peroxides. And there are 3 oxygens, which gives us figure -6. We ask what has to be put in here to make the sum correct. +5, of course. As in +5 -6 gives us, sorry, -1 there. So the oxidation number of the iodine here is +5. It's changing from +5, it's being reduced down to 0 because the oxidation number of any element is 0. What's happening there is it's gaining 5 electrons. Now here in the iodide ion, the oxidation number is -1, of course. So in this particular instance, it's going from -1 up to 0, so it's losing an electron. We need to balance this reaction so that we have the same number of electrons going in each direction. So we need to put 5 in here so that I can multiply this by 5. Now, with 3 oxygens in the iodate ion, we're going to get 3 water molecules. And you can see with 3 H2Os we need 6 H's, so we need 6 H+ in here, and that gives us the balanced reaction then. We need to balance the iodines out. We've got 5 I's here and 1 I in the iodate, so we need 3 I2's on the right to balance it. There you are, write that equation down. Let's take in some facts here. We've got 0.85 grams in each tablet. We have a total of 30 tablets. And one other subtlety to be picked up on this page is the following. We see that in the tablets, iodine is present as iodate, which is this ion here. And we see that 1 mole of that produces 3 moles of iodine. So we need to make sure that you record that as well before we proceed. So each tablet generates 3 moles of I2. Okay, let's move on then. Pause and have a go. You should remember the ratio of moles of iodine and sodium thiosulfate. Remember the indicator, fresh starch. And we don't add that to the flask until the colour is straw yellow, goes blue-black, and we continue titrating until it goes clear, colourless and clear. Let's look at the mark scheme answer. So it's 2 moles of sodium thiosulfate with 1 mole of iodine. We get 2 moles of NaI. And notice how these numbers, the S2 becomes S4, the O3 becomes O6. So notice how the numbers double up in the chemical on the right. Starch indicator. You add it near the end point when it's straw coloured. Pause and have a go here, please. We'll go back to the previous slide a moment just to remind you of the key values. Concentration of the sodium thiosulfate 0.02. Remember that the iodine solution from those tablets, 30 tablets, that 25 cubic centimeters was taken from the 250, so we took 1/10 of the total volume. So the iodine solution 0.02 molar. How do we express concentration? As the number of mole in a cubic decimeter. What does mole equal? It's the concentration times the volume in cubic decimeters. Concentration 0.02, the volume in cubic decimeters, 25 divided by 1000 is 0.025. Sorry, I took the wrong volume there. The volume of thiosulfate was 22.5, so 0.0225, and that comes out to be 0.3045 mole of the thiosulfate, S2O3 2 minus. And this bit, remember how 1 mole of iodine reacted with 2 moles of sodium thiosulfate. So if we know the number of moles of sodium thiosulfate, we can reason that half as many moles of I2 must have been present. So that's 0.0045 divided by 2, which is 0.30225 mole of I2. And this bit, well, in order to work out the mass, we multiply the number of moles by the relative atomic mass. Iodine is going to be 2 × 127. The relative atomic mass of iodine is 127, which gives us 254. So we've got 0.00225 times the relative atomic mass, 254. Grams, and that gives us 0.05715 grams of I2 present in that 25 cubic centimeters of solution. Now you see the answers. Pause and have a go. Well, remember how from the volumetric flask only 25 of the 250 cubic centimeters was removed for the titration. So in fact we have 10 times as much iodine solution. So we therefore multiply that mass, 0.05175, by 10, giving us a figure of 0.5175 grams. And here, this involves the subtlety I mentioned on the first page. Remember how in that reaction we had 5I minus plus IO3 minus plus 6H plus, etc., give 3I2 plus 3H2O. Subtlety again is that we're getting 3 moles of iodine generated for just 1 mole of IO3 actually present in the salt or in the tablets. So we'll have to factor this in, that this reaction is actually multiplying up by a factor of 6 the amount of iodine. So the amount of iodine showing up in this particular titration, we have actually only got one sixth of that amount of iodine present in the tablet. So we have a total of 30 tablets. So we take that total mass of iodine, 0.5175, and we divide by the number of tablets, which is 30, and that gives us the apparent amount of iodine per tablet, which is 0.019 grams. But remember, that's the apparent amount of iodine. To work out the actual amount of iodine, we'll have to divide that figure, 0.019, by 6, to take account of the fact that when we get 3 moles of I2, in other words the equivalent of 6I, that has been generated from just 1 mole of I, as an IO3 minus, actually present in the tablet. And that gives us a figure then of 0.0031 grams. And this bit, the percentage of iodine in each tablet, well, the actual mass then is 0.0031 grams per tablet, with each tablet weighing 0.085 grams. Multiply that by 100% to change it to a percentage, and that gives us a figure 3.65%. Moving on. Those are the figures we have. Pause and have a go at this, please. In this reaction, this first reaction A involves KOH reacting with H2SO4. The salt that we get will be K2SO4. So we need 2 moles of KOH to react with 1 mole of H2SO4. We need twice as many moles of the potassium hydroxide. Here we see the concentrations of the sulfuric acid and the potassium hydroxide are the same. We're taking twice the volume of potassium hydroxide, which effectively means we're taking twice as many moles, and that's the correct answer. Notice here, taking 10 of 0.6, if you're taking half the volume, 10 instead of 20, but taking twice the concentration, 0.6 instead of 0.3, this is effectively the same number of moles as 20 of 0.3. In other words, it's reacting the KOH and sulfuric acid in equimolar amounts, which is wrong. This is just the same thing, taking the same volume, same concentration of sulfuric acid as KOH, taking them in equimolar amounts, that's wrong. We need twice as many moles of KOH. And here, we're taking 20 of 0.6, we're doubling the concentration of the sulfuric acid. We're taking twice as many moles of H2SO4 as KOH, when in fact it should be the other way around. Pause and have a go. How did you get on? Did you get A? Let's see why. The formula is H2SO4. four oxygens, they contribute a mass of 416.64. Sulfur contributes a mass of 32, and the two hydrogens contribute a mass of 2. It gives us a relative molecular mass of 98, of which sulfur is 32. So 98 grams of sulfuric acid needs how many grams of sulfur to make it? Needs 32 grams. We could work out what 1 gram needs. 32, if 98 needs 32, 1 needs 32 divided by 98. And that is 0.3265 grams. And if 1 gram needs that number of grams, then if we multiply both sides by a million, which is what a ton is 1,000 kilograms, or 1,000 times 1,000 grams, a million, so we do that to both sides, then effectively 1 million grams of H2SO4, which is a ton, will need 3265 grams of sulfur, or in simple terms, we change it to tons, means that 1 ton of H2SO4 needs, or if we use the equivalent sign, it's equivalent to 0.3265 tons or ton of sulfur, and at a cost of £160 a ton, then it's going to be the cost £165 times the number of tons, 0.3265 tons, and that comes out to give us a figure of £52.24. So the answer is A. Moving on. Pause and have a go. Let's work out the relative molecular mass of diborium. That's B2H6. Two borons, that's 2 11s or 22, and then the six hydrogens. Gives us six, that gives us a total of 28. 1 mole of B2H6 would be 28 grams. What would 7 grams be? Remember this rearrangement triangle. Mole is the mass divided by the relative molecular mass. If we want the number of mole, then it's going to be the mass, which is 7 grams divided by the relative molecular mass, 28. 7 goes into 28 four times, a quarter, or 0.25 mole of B2H6. Now look at the balanced equation. 1 mole of B2H4, how many moles of gas does it produce? Well, both products we see here are gases, and we're producing 6 moles of HF and 2 moles of BF3, a total 6 and 2, 8 moles of gas on the right hand side. So 0.25 mole of B2H6 makes, going to make eight times as many moles of gas, because we see in the balance equation that 1 mole here on the left produces 8 moles of gas on the right. So that's going to be 8 times 0.25 mole of gas. So that's 2 moles of gas is produced, which is going to be twice 24 dm cubed, because a mole of gas under standard conditions, conditions room temperature and pressure, taken to be 20 degrees C here in one atmosphere, one mole of any gas occupies 24 dm cubed, so 2 moles will be twice that, and the answer therefore is 48 cubic decimeters of gas will be produced. have a go at this. Did you get this? Boron trifluoride, of course. Boron, atomic number 5, configuration 2-3. In its valence shell, it has only got 3 electrons. When it bonds with 3 fluorines, each fluorine comes in. I won't bother showing the fluorines, all the fluorines' electrons. Do it in just one instance here. This fluorine will have electrons like that, as will the others. So here the boron has what we call an incomplete octet. It doesn't have 8, but 6 electrons. The boron has got 3 bonding pairs of electrons in its valence shell. They will repel one another mutually. And the best shape to get those as far away as possible is a flat or planar shape known as trigonal. And this explains why it takes that shape. You need to mention the repulsions of electrons, causing them to go as far away as possible and adapt a shape that suits that. Pause and have a go here, please. Sorry, this is just the answer again. Give me the answer here to that, so we'll just move on. No, sorry, go ahead. Try this. Write an equation for the reaction. Calcium fluoride, CaF2. Calcium's a 2 plus ion. Fluoride's a single minus ion, so we need 2 fluorides. Reacting with concentrated sulfuric acid. What does this remind you of? When we're making the hydrogen halides, we certainly think in terms of something like sodium bromide or sodium fluoride or sodium chloride reacting with conch sulfuric acid. There we get HBr plus NaHSO4. And of course, in this case, the concentrated sulfuric acid is a strong enough oxidizing agent to oxidize the HBr to bromine. It is itself reduced and SO2 is produced. Different story with hydrogen fluoride. Hydrogen fluoride will not be oxidized by concentrated sulfuric acid. So here's the reaction on this occasion. We're getting calcium sulfate formed in this instance. As was indicated. And hydrogen fluoride. Pause and have a go at all of these, please. And if you're ready, we'll go and look at the 3 answers here. Calcium fluoride, 40 for the calcium, 2 fluorines, 2 19s, gives us a total of 78 as the relative molecular mass. Moles. Mole is the mass divided by the relative molecular mass. So we divide the mass. We divide the mass, 0.0025, by the relative molecular mass, 78, gives us 0.4032 moles. And the number of moles of fluoride ions? Well, in every 1 mole of calcium fluoride, we have 2 mole of F minus, twice as many moles. So we multiply that by 2 to get 6.4 by 10 to the minus 5. 0.4064. Pause and have a go. Well, this one we just worked out a moment ago. If we go back, we see here that we had 6.4 by 10 to the minus 5 moles. That was that particular mass of calcium fluoride, 6.4 by 10 to the minus 5 mole present in 100 cubic centimeters. What would the number of moles be per liter, which is 1,000 cubic centimeters? Simply multiply that by 10, so it'll be 6.4 by 10 to the minus 4 mole per liter. And this fluoride helps guard against tooth decay? And why do some people object? Well, everyone needs water for drinking, for cooking. And if this is put in for us, we have no choice in the matter. And this is a form of mass medication. So, and reduces freedom of choice. After all, people can use fluoride toothpaste and so on. Pause and have a go at this, please. This is a ratio question, carbon to chlorine to oxygen. In terms of these numbers, they add up to 100. They're percentage by mass. So if we considered it in grams, we'd have 18.9 grams of this, 55.9 grams of this, and 25.2 grams of this. Pause and change these to moles, and then work out the empirical formula. So this is 18.9 divided by the relative atomic mass to change it to moles, 12. 55.9 divided by 35.5, the relative atomic mass of chlorine. And 25.2 divided by 16, the relative atomic mass of oxygen, will change all of those to moles. And this comes out to be 1.575. This comes out to be also 1.575. And this comes out to be, again, 1.575. We divide across, at this stage of such a calculation, we divide across by the smallest number, which clearly is 1.575, so it's 1 to 1 to 1. The empirical formula is therefore CClO. And this question, think of the valency of these atoms. Carbon's valency is 4, chlorine's valency is 1, oxygen's valency is 2. Let's see if we could connect those. Cl, we could start with a carbon to the Cl. We could have a double bond to the oxygen. The chlorine is satisfied with its valency of 1. The oxygen is satisfied with its valency of 2. But the carbon isn't. It is only 3 bonds and it needs to have 4. Okay. Pause again, take in the information here. 2 moles of ammonium chloride reacting with 1 mole of the alkali. When you react any ammonium compound with an alkali and you heat it, you always get ammonia produced. In fact, you get a salt, ammonia and water produced when an ammonium compound is warmed with an alkali. The ammonia that is collected here, NH3, has a molar mass, well, the N's 14, so I should be NH3 here first. The three H's give us 3, so the molar mass of ammonia is 17. That's to say 17 grams per mole. Air is nitrogen and oxygen, 4/5 nitrogen, 1/5 oxygen roughly. The molar mass of nitrogen, 2/14 is 28. The molar mass of oxygen, 2/16 is 32. So if we average that out, as a molar mass of air of around about 29 roughly, then we can see that ammonia with a molar mass of 17 is less dense than air, and here it's been collected by the downward displacement of air. It rises up here and it pushes the air down. Pause and have a go at this, please. Sorry, I should have read this question in advance. I've just explained this. So, move on and look at this. Going back to the reaction here, you see that 2 moles of ammonium chloride react with 1 mole of calcium hydroxide to produce 2 moles of ammonia. key thing is that if 2 moles of this produce 2 moles of that, 1 mole of ammonium chloride would produce 1 mole of ammonia. And we have an excess of calcium hydroxide, so 1 mole of ammonium chloride is equivalent to, or will produce, 1 mole of NH3. We need to work out what 1.05 grams of ammonium chloride is in terms of moles. Remember, mole, mass and relative molecular mass are related according to this. So the mole, if we cover mole is equal to the mass divided by the relative molecular mass. This is the last occasion in which I'll use this. You're probably bored with these now. So it's going to be the mass, which is 1.07, divided by the relative molecular mass. Well, to work out the relative molecular mass of this chemical NH4Cl, let's see. The nitrogen, that's 14. 4 hydrogens, 4. And the chlorine, 35.5. We add those together. They come out to be 53.5 in total. Now, so that's 1.07 here over to the top right, divided by 53.5. And that gives us the number of moles of ammonium chloride, which is 0.02. So if 1 mole down here at the bottom, if 1 mole of ammonium chloride gives 1 mole of ammonia, 0.02 mole will give 0.2 mole of ammonia. In this question, we've been asked to work out the volume of ammonia at 20 degrees C in 1 atmosphere. 1 mole of any gas under those conditions occupies 24 dm cubed. So that's going to be equal to 0.02 times 24 cubic decimeters. And that's clearly 0.48. dm cubed. Sorry, I'm having difficulty there. dm cubed. 0.48 dm cubed. Let's look at the I don't have the answer for this one. So just pause if you need to take anything in there. I'll read from the mark scheme. For part A, ammonia, it wanted you to identify that to have a relative molecular mass of 17, oxygen 32, nitrogen 28. You got 2 marks for identifying those. And then a statement that the ammonia is lighter than air. And yes, the answer to B is 0.48 dm cubed. Moving on. Pause and have a go. Here are the answers. Ammonia is an alkaline gas and it will therefore turn moist. Universal indicator paper, blue or blue violet. You may recall from the diagram at the start of this question that calcium oxide was present in the test tube. Calcium oxide is a suitable drying agent, being alkaline. It's suitable for drying this alkaline gas. Conosulfuric acid is an excellent drying agent, but in this case, an acid-alkali reaction will take place. And this reaction, of course, you're very familiar with. Ammonia and HCl, they are invisible gases, but when they meet, they form white smoke of ammonium chloride. Pause and have a go, please. The oxidation number of nitrogen here, well, nitrogen is more electronegative than hydrogen, much further to the right, more electronegative than hydrogen. Hydrogen will have its normal oxidation number of plus 1. There are 3 hydrogens, so that's plus 3 overall. The ammonia molecule is neutral. So clearly, to make this sum correct, what do I have to put in here? minus 3. So here nitrogen has a minus 3 oxidation number. In any element, the oxidation number is 0. So on the right, nitrogen has an oxidation number of 0. Its oxidation number is being increased from minus 3 up to 0. Nitrogen is being oxidized. Copper on the left, plus 2. Oxygen, minus 2. The oxidation number of oxygen remains minus 2 on the right. Nothing's happening to the oxygen by way of oxidation and reduction. But the copper is forming an element on the right, oxidation number 0. Its oxidation number is falling from plus 2 to 0. The copper is being reduced, therefore. Let's look at the mark scheme answer, showing that the oxidation number of the nitrogen is going from minus 2 up to 0, and nitrogen is being oxidized. Copper's oxidation number is going from plus 2 to 0, and the copper is being reduced. Pause and have a go at this, please. Nitrogen atomic number 7, configuration 2-5. Hydrogen atomic number 1, configuration 1. Nitrogen has got 5 electrons in its valence shell. Did you get this? Moving on. Pause and have a go. Remember that the nitrogen has got 4 electrons in its valence shell. We've got 2 electrons up here that would be described as non-bonding valence electrons. And then we've got the others, 3 bonding pairs. So this is the shape, it's described as pyramidal. If you visualize a pyramid like this, imagine the nitrogen here, the peak of the pyramid, the triangular base pyramid, and then hydrogens at each of these corners. If you include the lone pair, you could actually consider the nitrogen in the middle here, somewhere embedded just above the center of this triangular base pyramid, with the hydrogens again here. And then the lone pair kind of sitting up in this position here, I suppose. And the explanation. You do need to mention about the lone pair. Not shown here, but you should mention the lone pair. And the explanation that electrons, pairs of electrons, repel. And that completes these 2 years of mole calculations. AS. No getting away from moles. You may be tempted to sit and learn reams of information, but you're fooling yourself if you don't practice moles and try to get better. There are 2 other snapcasts in the series. Do consider looking at them as well. So thanks for listening.